Hi, I'm Wes Solom. I'm a genetic counselor from HD Genetics, a company dedicated to providing remote genetic counseling and genetic testing options for the HD community. But today I'm here on behalf of HDYO, the Huntington's Disease Youth Organization, for a series called HDYou. This is to share stories from the HD community that are told by and for the HD community. Deciding to test for HD is one of the biggest decisions someone at risk for HD can face. And today we're going to hear from Meg about her own experience and considerations surrounding HD and the decision of whether to seek predictive genetic testing. Hi, Meg.
Hi.
Meg, can you share with us a little bit about yourself, kind of where you're coming from, where you are, and what's your connection to HD?
I'm Meg. I am from Colorado, United States. I have known about HD for over half my life. It's on my mom's side of the family. So I've been at risk for, well, almost, my whole last 15 years that I've known. And then this last year, I went through the testing process, and the last basically 2 years was when I kind of really was thinking about just like deciding to test or not. So really the last 2 years is when everything kind of shifted and I started that testing process.
Sure. And can you kind of walk me through what was it in these last 2 years that kind of came to be that really kind of shifted for you to start making that decision toward testing?
I think it started off, I wanted to build a community in HD because I didn't really have, like, I have my family. I love my family. They're very private about things. And so I kind of wanted to, like, meet more people in the community. And so I was able to find people through, like Instagram and Facebook. And as I, like, started, like, learning about those people's stories, talking about HD more with them, and also, like, super open conversations with my husband, and we him and I had had conversations before then too, but as we started talking more and more, kind of got to the decision of maybe I should actually get tested, because up until that point I had never ever planned on getting tested. I didn't think it was in the cards for me. I didn't think that I was going to be able to handle the results if I did end up testing positive, and so I was never going to up until that point. But really what shifted was finding that the HD community for me, and kind of having that like self-belief and courage that I could get through the testing process.
Gotcha. Okay. So it was really, it sounds like kind of sparked through connecting through social media and getting connected with other folks that are from the HD community.
100%. There's two people in my mind. So there's one girl from HDYO ambassador group. I reached out to her because I found her on TikTok, and like her and I had like the best conversations. And so her, and then there's also this woman, Brooke. I don't know her last name. She's actually part of the ALS community. She has
Oh, cool.
ALS, and she is very open about it and talks about it a lot. And so those two were kind of my first like inspirations. And again, also like all the conversations with my husband, and kind of just switched my mind completely to getting tested. And so kind of a big shift there.
Interesting. Yeah, that's interesting to hear. So what kind of influenced that shift, would you say? Were the conversations kind of immediately kind of heavy in it, talking about HD, or was it kind of more kind of getting familiar with folks and then kind of lightly treading that path and then talking deeper about it?
No, I think it went like deep dive into HD, and I've always been open to talking about HD. I've always wanted to talk about HD because it's something that, I mean, I feel like it's the same way with like my emotions and my thoughts. Like I've always just been kind of an open book, but I just haven't had the quite the right like resources to talk to it, I suppose. So went deep dive into starting talking about HD. And so having that was like, I had inspiration from those two. I was able to really talk about how I was feeling with everything. Better conversations with my husband, more, and so that's just was the, again, like the big shift, I suppose.
Okay. Yeah. So it sounds like the process of leading up to that decision making was sort of fueled by finding community, connecting with community, having open conversations, And conversations that you were already having with your husband, but that kind of like what's the word? Kind of like an enrichment or something by being connected with other folks in the HD community.
Yeah, 100%. Like, I think it made me feel like I wasn't alone, and it made me feel like I could get through the process and get through the result no matter what happened at the end. And like, having that community gave me the extra support that I needed for myself to believe that I could get through it and do it and get on the other side.
Sure. But it sounds like community was a very big player for you in making this decision or coming to this decision. Were there any other kind of factors surrounding your decision to seek genetic testing?
Yeah, it was also for my husband and I, like our family planning. I know that's kind of a big thing for a lot of people in the HD community. Definitely something that I was worried about. I found there's a lot of resources out there though. There's so a lot of families do like PGT and IVF. You can do it. You can do PGT IVF, not test, like you can do it, what's it called, like anonymously. So where like you don't find your test result, but the child that you have would be negative. So we did talk about that, but I think ultimately I did want to know my gene status, and I kind of, you know, made me realize I wanted to know my entire life. It took me a long time to get to the point where I thought that I could, you know, like I'd be okay finding out. So yeah, really it was just like the family planning was the other thing.
Sure. Yeah. It's, I think the process that you're describing is a non-disclosure testing
Yes.
where,
Yeah.
Yeah. Where folks are, to clarify for folks that are not familiar, this is an option that's out there for the HD community that basically you're able to seek predictive genetic testing on embryos and only implanting those embryos that are free of risk of HD, so that if you're not ready to learn your own genetic status, you're able to do so, where you don't have to learn your genetic status at that time and can instead move forward with these options for mitigating risk for pregnancy. A lot of people don't know that that exists. So that is something to kind of bring up. I think that's good to mention. Yeah.
Definitely. I think that was another really great thing of learning from like social media, along with the community. Like, just there's so many resources out there, and it was really, really encouraging for me to be able to find those resources, like really kind of life changing. And so that's why, like, I'm, you know, I want to be doing things like here today, you know, potentially helping someone, or, you know, I don't know, just being a part of the community, making it more known and bigger, you know.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. And you know, I've heard from some folks that have learned of that option, the non-disclosure testing option, and kind of found it helpful to know that that option is out there, but ultimately decided to test themselves. So that's interesting to hear that that was the way you took as well.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah.
I think, yeah, we talked about, yeah, totally.
Yeah. Did you have any, you know, we've talked about folks from social media that you connected with and your husband. Were there any other sources of support that you were kind of consulting in this process or kind of talking with or exploring the option with?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I have, like I said, like I have my family, and my family is very private about things, which obviously I very much respect, and they respect me as well. And so I have my family, and we're very close, and I have all my friends. Like, my best friend, I'd say, was, other than my husband, like the number one person. Like, she's known about HD in my family like as long as I have, and so she's definitely someone that I lean on. She also, actually, her parents had a family friend that passed away from HD as well, so there's definitely that connection as well with her. I also was able to lean on some of my coworkers, and my boss was really amazing during the whole process. And yeah, it was great. Really, really, I mean, I would say great as in it was really important for me to have that support, because it's not easy to go through, but when you have great people that support you surrounding it and in your life, it's really, really impactful.
Yeah, absolutely. And what you just mentioned about having your friend be connected to HD, it sounds like it was very helpful to have folks to be able to talk to you that were familiar with HD.
Absolutely. Yeah. Like, you know, my friends that didn't know about HD that I've talked to about it, they've educated themselves and they've been really great support. But my best friend, she's seen it, you know, she had that already. So that's really good to have too for me.
Sure. Did you participate in genetic counseling before or during the process? Did you go through like kind of a formal genetic counseling process or genetic testing process?
Yeah, so I'm not sure what it's like for all the testing centers in the US, but the where I got tested was it's pretty like they pretty specific process that you have to go through before you go to the day like of the blood draw. So I met with I talked with the social worker on the phone, the genetic counselor, both of those before I even went to the clinic. And so my genetic counselor was absolutely amazing. My husband and I both talked with her over Zoom. I thought it was only going to be like a one-time meeting, but she was absolutely incredible. And she just, you know, it was a great conversation to begin with, like the entire time. But she, you know, she said, I want to be here for you guys through the whole process. Do you want to talk again before you go to the clinic? And I said, I would actually really like that. So I think we met with her. I think we met with her twice before I got tested, right after I got tested, and then right after I got my results. So I've seen her multiple times, and just a great support from her. She was incredible.
That's great. That's great to hear. Did you have multiple connections with the social worker as well? Well, sometimes folks are a little confused about what the social worker does in that.
The social worker at the clinic that she is great. I really only spoke with her specifically that one time at the beginning, because she kind of, I think she does a lot of like intake possibly of people, just information and stuff. And then she kind of gave the information about what the testing would look like. She's at the clinic, but other than that, I really wish it's that first time that I talked with her. But she said, you know, she's there as a support and a resource if I needed.
Sure. Gotcha. Yeah. And sounds like you had a pretty steady connection with the genetic counselor through the process.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Gotcha. Is there anything that you found sort of surprising or like unexpected about the genetic counseling process?
Do you mean like with my genetic counselor or just the whole process?
Oh, just the whole process. Yeah. Anything that sort of you weren't expecting, or was it kind of like going into it, you're like, this is kind of what I expected from this situation?
I felt like I did a good amount of research beforehand, so I kind of knew what to expect. I didn't know that it was going to be kind of like, I don't want to say like rigorous, but I didn't know like that I would be talking to so many different people before I would even get the blood draw. A really important part of the testing process, but I guess I didn't really expect that before. Trying to think. I don't think. And if I think of something, I'll say it again. But
sure. Yeah. Yeah, I know that it can be kind of fun to be like, well, I think I expect. Did I? Yeah.
Yeah.
So that makes sense. Sure. It sounds like you did a lot of thorough thought and into considering this process in the first place. So you came in kind of prepared of what it would look like.
Absolutely. I feel like I did a lot of, you know, I know I keep saying right now, like I, you know, and I'm like smiling and I'm like, you know, and I, you know, I'm grateful to be where I am right now, but it was definitely an emotional process and it was not easy. And, you know, there are a lot of times where, you know, there were some hard days in there for sure, but I honestly wouldn't change anything about it, the whole process. And I think it helped that I did, you know, I did my research beforehand and I knew the clinic I was going to. I trusted it very well and very much. And
Sure. Yeah. Did you, of course, acknowledging the heaviness and kind of the undeniable that, you know, reality of that situation and just kind of going into that that it was in fact hard. Did you ever have any sort of hesitation or any doubts while you were kind of going through the process of, you know, whether or not to continue or follow through with it?
I think I probably had some thoughts here and there, like, am I really ready for this? Am I really doing the right thing? Really going back to just having so many conversations with my husband about it, and just him and I both being open with each other about our plans for the future, the reason that I'm getting tested, the pros and the cons. And I think just being open with how I was feeling every moment really helped that. So I didn't ever really consider like stopping testing. I think I got, you know, nervous here and there, questioned if it was the right thing. I think that's probably a pretty normal experience. But no, I never was truly thinking that I didn't want to be a part of it.
Sure. Yeah. And everyone's testing experience from what I've heard is different. And what you're describing is not, you know, it's not uncommon to have these sort of reevaluations throughout the process and sort of say, is this the right time? Is this what I want to do?
Yeah. I feel like my process was also a little bit longer than most people, because my husband and I had to kind of sort out a couple things at the beginning before I could even see the genetic counselor. And then we went on our honeymoon in between. And then, like, so that kind of like set it like a month later. And then, you know, we had to do all these different things. And so it kind of made the process feel longer. So then it made me feel like I was, you know, emotionally kind of that entire time, like longer than other people's, I suppose. So yeah, that's the only thing that I maybe wish had been a little bit different, if it had been, could have been a little bit shorter, but
okay.
I think, yeah, but yeah, I know everyone is different for sure.
Gotcha. So are you saying like the length of that process, the kind of prolonging it made it a little difficult or harder than it would have been if it had been a little more condensed?
I think so.
Okay.
Yeah, like I know, like I have a friend that his was like, I think like 3 months long from start to finish, and mine was like 7 months long from start to finish kind of thing.
Got it.
Yeah, so.
Gotcha. Okay. How did you feel about that time? You know, I've heard folks talk about the time of essentially waiting for your results, you know, having that period. First, how long did you have to wait? And second, how did that feel for you?
So I had to wait a month. So
okay.
I think that's a pretty normal time period, I think, for people, just because the blood has to go to like a specific lab or whatever for results and stuff. I definitely made sure during that month to keep myself busy. I was working. I think I took like maybe like a week or half a week off before I got my test result, and then I took a whole week off afterwards. So having that, knowing that I wasn't gonna, you know, be at work, kind of helped a little bit. But definitely keeping myself busy during that month, and also like this whole process, just being aware of how I was feeling emotional, being open about it, just being aware of how I was feeling and what I was thinking, really helped me. I don't keep things in very well, and I, you know, it helps me to process outwardly. So definitely continuing to do that was really good.
Okay, sure. Yeah. So it sounds like you had a means of keeping yourself busy throughout that process. But then had time kind of surrounding that results session where you were able to kind of have time for yourself and prepare for that appointment, and then also have the time afterward to kind of let the dust settle, so to speak.
Exactly. Yep. I wanted to do it. I wanted to be really intentional about what I was doing with my time before and after, because I knew that I wasn't going to get it back. You know, and I wanted to just honor my thoughts and my emotions during that whole thing. So definitely taking that time away from work, putting it towards, you know, my friends and my family and myself was really important to me.
Yeah, sure. Okay. Yeah, it's absolutely an interesting point that in this process, the time that's involved with the genetic counseling and testing process can vary for various reasons. Mm-hmm. For you, it sounds like you had personal things going on that kind of contributed to mm-hmm. taking that time yeah. and kind of pulling out a bit. But it can also take a little bit longer, just depending on what that protocol is with the center totally. Or the clinic or just various things in a person's life. That kind of thing. But yeah, sounds like you had a very thoughtful approach to this and were able to kind of go about it a way that worked well for you.
Absolutely. I think, you know, with something as big as HD, I definitely, you know, wanted and needed to be intentional about what I was doing and what my plan was. I don't think anyone really could take it lightly. I mean, I guess you could if you don't really think about what it means to be impacted by HD, but I don't think anyone would in the community anyways. But yeah, I wanted to definitely be intentional about all of that because of the severity of the situation, you know.
Sure. How was that period for you immediately following testing?
So I did end up testing positive. I had a plan, like I said, you know, going, you know, before I had a plan before the test, I had a plan after. So, you know, no matter what was going to happen, I had the plan. We were going to mm-hmm. Go up, you know, I had stuff with my friends and my family. And so I think that was, you know, a nice kind of like, not distraction, definitely wasn't a distraction, but a really important way for me to have good coping from the beginning. You know, that I was surrounded by my husband and my friends and my family and doing mm-hmm. something that I love and, you know, getting a life altering diagnosis was, I mean, it's terrifying and it's devastating, but it doesn't have to change who I am as a person. And, you know, I think being intentional from the beginning, right after I got the result, about how I was going to respond to those results has been really helpful for me moving forward and how I want to live the rest of my life. If that makes sense.
Absolutely. That makes perfect sense. And it sounds like you have a really great support system as far as your husband, your friends that you mentioned, your family.
I do. Yeah. I, you know, definitely wouldn't have been able to get through the whole process without them and, you know, be on the other side, knowing the result now and knowing, you know, what's going to happen in the future. I definitely lean on them and I'm going to continue to lean on them, you know?
Sure. And just a quick clarification that, you know, receiving a positive genetic test mm-hmm. result for Huntington's mm-hmm. disease, is not technically a diagnosis. That's reserved for a clinical assessment where neurologists may observe symptoms of HD. So while you test positive for that genetic cause of HD, it's not necessarily that overnight that those symptoms yeah. develop. Or yeah,
that's true. Yeah, so I guess I should say, tested positive for the gene.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. Sure. Totally. Yeah. Yeah.
I know what? That I think a big thing for me that I, you know, I've said multiple times and I remind myself that this is something that was completely out of my control. And it's the mm-hmm. same thing for people that test negative. I know there's a lot of feelings around testing negative as well, but anyone in the HD community knows that this isn't something that we choose. It's not our fault and it doesn't change who we are at all. You know, this gene that I've had my entire life, you know, but I'm still the same person that I've always been. And I'm going to continue to be the same person that I've always been. You know, I just have the knowledge now of that. I have this part of me, you know, and how can I live my life now knowing that this is my reality?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, that's something that I'll often talk about in genetic counseling sessions, that this is uncovering information, right? That's always been with you. It's not necessarily something that changes, right? So yeah, that absolutely. Yeah.
There, I feel like there is a lot of shame, but I'm trying to, you know, and I think a lot of people in the HD community are trying to change that because, like I said, it's not our fault and it's not something that we chose for ourselves at all, you know. So,
absolutely. Yeah. Looking back, is there anything that you wish you had known or wish you had done differently when you engaged in this process of seeking genetic testing?
Yeah. You know, I'm really looking back at it. I'm really proud of myself for how I handled it and, you know, handled myself moving forward. And, you know, I wish I had had that like self-compassion from the beginning. You know, I think I tried to, and, you know, there's, you know, no one's perfect and, you know, you have moments where, you know, it comes and goes, but, I certainly have a lot of other times in my life, not related to HD, where I could definitely be more self-compassionate, but, yeah, I don't know. It's so different looking back 2020, you know, look, or what do they say? Vision is like looking back, whatever, but,
hindsight 2020.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I think that's the only thing I can think of. Cause besides that, I really did have a good testing experience and I'm really grateful for, all the support and resources that I had.
That's great. That's great to hear. Was there other, were there specific forms of support or, resources that come to mind, outside of what was personal to you as far as social media or friends or family? Any things that you leaned on or remember in that process that other people would be able to access?
You mean like resources that they could have?
Yeah. Sorry, that might not have been the most clear way to ask that. Potentially, like, are there support groups or certain websites or something that maybe you were kind of looking through or connecting with?
Yeah, definitely. So there's a lot of support, obviously, through HDYO, like incredible resource. HDSA is awesome. I joined the Rocky Mountain chapter that, so there's chapters kind of around the country for HDSA.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of resources within each chapter there, which I didn't know about before. So now I know.
Sure.
There's a lot of the stuff that I found is through Instagram. A lot of, you know, like, I think are you part of HD? Is it HD Reach?
There is HD Reach.
There's a book club, there's mm-hmm. a bunch of HDSA runs, you know, there's like so many different things. Like there's so many different things. And so, definitely, would encourage to like, look for sure on that, you know, search on the internet and support groups too. Yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Great to hear. Well, what would you say to someone from the HD community that's maybe considering genetic testing?
I think, like you said at the beginning, it is a very big decision and it's super personal. I'd say it's important to test for you, no one else. People might pressure you, or, you know, you might sway back and forth between what you think is right or what you don't think you should do. But at the end of the day, like, you need to do what is right for you. I never thought that I was going to get tested ever. Like, I was dead set on never getting tested. And then here I am, you know, however many years later, and like, I tested and I know my result. And I think, yeah, I don't know. I feel like I'm not explaining myself very well. Do the test if you think that that's going to help you. And if you think that, yeah, I don't know. I'm not answering it very well. Sorry.
No, yeah. I didn't want to interrupt your thought. I think you're answering it very well and very clearly.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. I appreciate that. Yeah. It's very important to not feel pressured or be pressured or do the test for, like you said, any other reason other than for you. And if that's in line with your own values and what you're finding to be what you're drawn to, if you're feeling like testing, then absolutely. If you are feeling like you don't want to test, or you feel that hesitation, or don't really feel like it's appropriate for you, but sort of feel like people maybe expect you to, or mm-hmm. something like that, absolutely do. There's no obligation to test. You know, absolutely. You do not have to test. Yeah.
Cause I mean, you do, you know, you do have to be prepared for whatever result you get, but that's what mm-hmm. you also learn during the process, is that, you know, you talk to your genetic counselor about the, you know, pros and cons to both, I suppose. So yeah, testing for you and preparing for you and knowing what is right for you.
Absolutely. Well, Meg, is there anything else that you'd like to share with the community about your experience, or anything that we haven't brought up that you're feeling like, I was hoping to maybe talk about this or mention something?
Well, thank you for everything that we've talked about and letting me be open about my experience and my story. I think the HD community is extremely resilient. That includes, you know, everyone from at risk, negative, positive. If you have, you know, maybe you don't have a direct connection to someone with HD, but you know about HD, you know, everyone in this community that knows about HD is incredibly resilient. And I'm really grateful to be able to be a part of this community. And I would encourage people to reach out and know that they have resources and that they're not alone. Cause really that was completely life-changing for me, to meet these people, and, you know, helped me completely shift my mind to, I got this. I know I'm going to be okay no matter what happens. And, you know, we do have hope for the future, and, you know, whatever happens, we're all going to have each other, you know?
Absolutely. I couldn't have said that better myself. That was fantastic, Mike. Yeah. And speaking of resources, you know, just to make sure that everyone is aware that, first of all, thank you, Meg, for sharing your story, and having this conversation with us today. And we just want to make sure that everyone's aware that if there's any, desire to kind of, connect and get out there and kind of connect with the community, there are so many, various resources out there, but most directly in connection with this video, feel free at any time to reach out or connect with HDYO, the Huntington's Disease Youth Organization. We have tons of education and support opportunities, and are happy to connect in whichever way you may find helpful.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Thanks, Meg.
Yeah, thank you so much. And HDYO, thank you guys.